News at Night for Tuesday, June the 8th. I'm Colette Linden.
I'm Craig Huckerby. It was a very muggy day today, and we did see some thunderstorm activity, but not here in the Sioux. Someplace in Algoma got some nasty weather. I'll show you that on radar. And we also have another chance of a thunderstorm tonight, so I'll show you all that coming up.
For the second straight day, the province sees the smallest daily increase of new infections since September. There have been fewer than 1,000 cases of COVID-19 for 9 consecutive days, and it is the first time Ontario has reported fewer than 500 new cases since September the 26th. The province is reporting a test positivity rate of 2.7%, which is down from 3.6% 1 week ago. It is the lowest positivity rate since March 12th. There were 17,579 tests completed in the last 24-hour period. There are 182 new cases in Toronto, 76 in Peel, 40 in the Porcupine Health Unit region, and 30 in Durham. There were another 1,000 resolved cases, dropping the active case count. Resolved cases have now outnumbered new infections each day since mid-April. The province reported 525 cases and 15 deaths on Monday. The mayors of Canadian border cities say Prime Minister Justin Trudeau's government has signaled it could start easing COVID-19 restrictions at the Canada-US frontier on June the 22nd if the country's vaccination campaign stays on its current trajectory. Jim Diodati, mayor of Niagara Falls, told Politico that Public Safety Minister Bill Blair delivered the message during a recent virtual meeting of border mayors from the province. But as vaccination rates rise, both national governments are under intensifying pressure to produce a reopening plan as a way to help struggling tourism industries and families who have been separated for more than 1 year. On the U.S. side, there has been calls for the Biden administration to start loosening measures at the American border without Canada if necessary. Since the border measures were first imposed, the countries have been renewing a bilateral month-to-month arrangement to keep them in place. The next agreement is set to expire on June 21st. On June 7th, officers with the Crime Suppression Unit, Emergency Services Unit, Investigations Unit, and Patrol Services arrested 50-year-old Jarriet LeVay on the strength of a warrant for second-degree murder. As a result of an ongoing investigation, officers were able to locate the accused around 3 o'clock in a residence in the 100 block of Wellington Street East. He was arrested without incident. He faces several charges, possession of a loaded firearm, possession of a firearm, and second-degree murder. He was held for bail court. Sharon Dolly Surrett is a mother, grandmother, auntie, author, storyteller, poet, and residential school survivor from Batchewana First Nation. She joins Sioux Online to share her story, accompanied by her niece, Jasmine Surrett, offering her support and words of comfort as her aunt recalled her days at school. Jasmine's father, Eugene Surrett, was Sharon's youngest brother. Normally, Yin would join Sharon in these types of talks and interviews and offer his drum and songs to open and close the conversation in a good way.
But give me a moment. Yeah. After the tragedy of this week, it was hard. And I was talking to my brother, my twin brother. He's out in Halifax. I said, did you have to move to the end of Canada? So anyways, he got married again out there. And I spoke to him yesterday. And he's still angry. My brother, they went... They didn't stay very long at Shinwalk. They managed to stay there a little bit, but her daddy ran away. I had to go bring him back home. And he got to stay home. I had to go back because I was there already a year. But, you know, find out after many years, I finally asked my sister, well, what happened to Mom? She left. Oh, I know she left. I said, why did she leave? She got tired. I said, tired? Tired? So I never seen her. I don't recall any memories of my mom, let alone grandparents. I just remember this old lady in the corner over there smoking a pipe. That's your grandma. Go say hi. Hello. That's the only one memory I have. And so my dad, he couldn't read or write. So children Jake got involved, of course, because he was just a seasonal worker. So he had to leave and he left my older sister in charge of us. Well, the system didn't like that, so children's aid said, well, it'd be best to bring him to Shinwalk over there. At least they'll get schooling and stuff. And of course, my dad signed away. He didn't know what he signed there, and then they were off. And it looked like a big building. It was really huge. And then okay, well, where's my brothers? Nope, can't go talk to them. You can't go play with them. You can't eat with them. They had to stay on that side. I was all alone on this side.
Sharon and her siblings attended Shingwalk Residential School from 1965 to 1970 when they closed their doors for good. The First Nations Major Projects Coalition is pleased to release its Roadmap to Investing in Canada, Indigenous Inclusion, an ESG report, which feature unprecedented thought leadership from private sector, public sector, and Indigenous nations. The report and associated top 10 list summarize outcomes from the recent Indigenous Sustainable Investment Conference, attended by over 1,500 participants. Experts from around the world participated in the conference to share their knowledge and learn about just about strategic application and interpretation of ESG principles. Both investors and Indigenous thought leaders are observing a sea change in the investment landscape when it comes to Indigenous-led equity investment. In tandem with the ESG movement, Indigenous nations and peoples in Canada and around the world are accessing and deploying an increasing amount of capital equity investment in major infrastructure and other projects.
Well, we came very close to seeing a severe thunderstorm roll through. I'll show you just who did see that thunderstorm. And there is another chance of a thunderstorm coming in later on tonight. And if you're not a fan of these stifling hot temperatures, I have some good news. Your weather's coming up right after this break.
On TV News, supported by James Seaton, Mortgage Specialist. Your new home doesn't come with mortgage advice. I do. Call James Seaton Mortgage Specialist, RBC, 705-975-1519.
Something to have for dinner.
Oh no, I never eat. I just nibble.
Well, if you're still hungry, there's half a chicken in the refrigerator.
Not anymore. That's what I nibble.
Believe some of those paintings people were doing, and you can do it. If you're not doing it, pick up a brush and join us, because you really can do it. There's no secret to this.
Welcome back, everyone. Well, we reached 31 today. Felt like 38 in the afternoon. It's going to be a muggy night tonight too. We'll show you the radar and just what's going on right now. We have a heat warning in the area around Elliott Lake. We also have a severe thunderstorm warning around North Bay, Sudbury, Timmins, all seeing a chance of, well, they actually did see some thunder and lightning today from a severe thunderstorm, and they also under the gun for another one later on tonight. So they're seeing all that active activity. We're not at the present, but we are watching some cells coming up from the north and also from the southwest that could give us a thunderstorm anytime after 9 o'clock tonight. So be aware of that. Otherwise, we're going to be basically staying with some cloud and just a mix of some clearing going on for our overnight. As far as overnight temperatures go, we're still fairly warm at 17 degrees here in the Sioux, 17 in Wawa, 11 degrees, a little cooler in Thunder Bay. That's the air that's coming our way over the next couple of days. We'll show you the systems map for tomorrow, and we do have a boundary setting up. So again, it gives us a shot for increasing clouds, some spotty showers, and some thunderstorm development, because this front is going to go back and forth over the Great Lakes. And if the ingredients are there, we will see that thunderstorm development. Other than that, we do have a cooling coming for the next couple of days. We'll get to that in a second. 26 for your evening tonight. Again, we have that chance of a thunderstorm. I'm not going to say it's a definite, but there is a chance of it. 17 degrees for your overnight with basically cloudy conditions, and we're going to start to see some clearing in the morning. Temperatures, though, still quite warm at 18 degrees. As we go on throughout the week, I'll start to speak English pretty soon. 28 degrees on Thursday, still warm, and we start to cool it down a little bit. We do see a little bit of an increase on Sunday. That's because of a warm front, but you can see some active weather coming our way as well. Saturday right now looks like a best shot of some all-day rain. That's the story right now, so we'll stick with it. 22 degrees though on Monday, and 24, so we're back to normal conditions as far as temperatures go for next week. So if you're not liking this warm stuff, There's some better air coming for next week. That's your weather right now. Let's send it to Jacob, who, Jacob, I guess it just wasn't in the cards for Winnipeg.
Well, Craig, you are right. The Winnipeg Jets were unable to win this game when they just couldn't get their game going. I'll have reactions from the Winnipeg Jets players and coaching staff, plus the rest of your sports, right after this break.
705 Sports with Jacob and Colette, Fridays at 4 p.m. 705 Sports, supported by YDOC Detailing. Call YDOC Detailing at 249-356-6688 to book an appointment for detailing or paint correction services today.
The Winnipeg Jets are now out of the playoffs after losing four straight to the Montreal Canadiens. Reporters had the chance to speak with the coaching staff and some of the players about how they feel about this series, what they did wrong, and what they need to do moving forward.
Extreme, right? Which was the case of the year. It was the story of the year. This was extreme. All these things that you'd never faced before. We played an NHL season without fans in the building. We played an NHL season without a road game in our time zone. There's a whole lot of things that we've never dealt with before. And you roll through four games against a team with the two best scorers in the league, and you like the defensive game, and then you get beat four straight times. They were good, and they were better than we were in this series, and they deserve to win.
Benson are big and heavy, and they do a good job of just clearing pucks and throwing them out of the zone, and we just like I said, I really felt like in any of these games, probably outside the first one, games two through four, if we just could have found a way to get that first goal, could be a different series, but we didn't, and you just got to give them so much credit. They're playing unbelievable right now.
Moving in now. Antonordi's the left shot with a right stick. Cross it goes, Eberle. He scores! Jordan Eberle on the weak side, left alone, and he picks a spot.
The Boston Bruins and the New York Islanders were going into Game 5 tied at two games apiece. Whoever wins Game 5 in a series is tied usually goes on to win the series. The Islanders went out and they were scoring early. Rask was pulled after allowing 4 goals on 16 shots for the Bruins. Boston looked to be out of this game, however they stormed back, making this game close. The Islanders were able to get one more goal in the third period to hang on to a 5-4 victory. The Islanders are now leading the series 3-2. We're going back to the Islanders' home ice, and if they can win Game 6, they will move on to the third round of the playoffs. If Boston is able to win the next game, we will see a Game 7. The Toronto Blue Jays are back on the diamond once again tonight to face the Chicago White Sox. This will be a very tall task for the Blue Jays, as the White Sox have had a very good season. The White Sox are currently sitting with 35 wins and 23 losses. The Jays are 6 games behind the Rays for first in the AL East and 5.5 games behind the Red Sox for second in the AL East, so they really need to start beating teams that are higher than them in the standings. This is the first of a 3-game mini-series against the White Sox.
Middle attacking Thomas, drop pass, Fultz, shoot, save, rebound, shot wide of the net by Mikkola. Penalty coming up on the Avalanche's fault. Is leveled in the slot.
Colorado Avalanche center Nazem Kadri should hear about his suspension today on whether it will be shortened or stay the same. Kadri was suspended 8 games for charging and intent to injure. Kadri and the Avalanche feel this suspension was too much for what the hit was. This is Kadri's last resort to try and get this suspension reduced. The reasoning for this suspension being so large is Kadri is a repeat offender. However, there are many people around the NHL who feel 8 games was just too much. Toronto Maple Leafs forward Zach Hyman could be a free agent on July 28th. There has been rumors going around that Hyman just declined a $5 million a year extension deal. Hyman's agent has came to Twitter to defend Hyman and say that this is not true. He reported that there has been no offer by the Toronto Maple Leafs for $5 million a year. Zach Hyman could get up to $6.5 million on the open market, according to Sportsnet's own Chris Johnson. We'll just have to wait and see whether Zach Hyman re-signs with Toronto or moves on to another team. We have two games going on in the NHL playoffs tonight, so let's break them down. The first game we have is the Tampa Bay Lightning versus the Carolina Hurricanes. Tampa Bay is looking to clinch this series and move on to the next round with a win tonight. Well, Carolina is desperately trying to stay alive and at least push this to Game 6. There are no expected line changes for either team. The second game we have going on is the Colorado Avalanche versus the Vegas Golden Knights. This series is all tied up at 2. Colorado really started off this series and they started off by dominating. Game 3 and 4 was a completely different story. Vegas seemed to find their game and Marc-Andre Fleury was stopping everything. Going into Game 5, both of these teams really want to win this game and take over this series. Well, that's it for sports, but always stay locked on TV. We always keep you updated on everything you need to know of what's going on. But stay right here. Colette's got more news right after this break.
On TV News, supported by Gary Chervinsky, Exit Realty, Lake Superior. Buying a home is a big decision, so is choosing the right agent. Call Gary Chervinsky, broker at Exit Realty, Lake Superior, 705-257-5432.
Don't click it, Mike. It's a scam.
Oh, hi, Voice of Reason. It looks legit.
Don't click. Listen to your voice of reason before you act.
I deleted it.
Canada.ca/bscamsmart can help.
On June the 7th, officers with patrol services charged 23-year-old Brandon Crack with assault with a weapon. Around 10:50 in the morning, officers responded to a disturbance call at a residence in the 0-100 block of Abbott Street. Upon arrival, an investigation revealed the accused forced his way into a residence of people he knew, threatened the victims, and threw a brick at one of the people inside the residence. Upon arrival, officers located the accused and he was arrested. He is charged with assault with a weapon, break and enter, uttering threats, breach of recognizance, and breach of probation. He was released on an undertaking and is scheduled to appear in court on July 19th. The Ontario Provincial Police are searching the waters of Lake Erie at Turkey Point for a missing 8-year-old boy. They say they were called to the area where he was last seen at around 5:30 p.m. on Saturday. Police say the boy was seen swimming in the lake after abandoning a floating raft but never made it back to shore. Family members sought help from police when they could not locate their son. Acting Staff Sergeant Ed Sanchuk says members of the Norfolk County OPP and its Marine Unit searched all night and are continuing to look throughout the last few days. He says the Underwater Search and Recovery Unit has been called to the scene to assist. Multiple websites went offline briefly across the globe Tuesday after an outage at the cloud service company Fastly, revealing how critical a handful of companies running the internet's plumbing have become. Dozens of sites, including the New York Times, CNN, some Amazon sites, Twitch, Reddit, The Guardian, and the UK government's homepage could not be reached. In Asia, cities like Hong Kong and Singapore were also affected, with users unable to access the CNN website. In China, where most foreign media websites are blocked, there was little discussion on the outage on social media platforms such as Weibo. San Francisco-based Fastly acknowledged a problem just before 6 a.m. Eastern. It said in repeated updates on its website that it was continuing to investigate the issue. All major future markets are in the U.S. dipped sharply minutes after the outage hit, almost exactly 1 month after a cyber attack that caused the operator of the largest fuel pipeline in the U.S. to halt its operations. Internet traffic measurement by Kentik show that Fastly began to recover from the outage roughly an hour after it struck at mid-morning European time and before most Americans were awake. When the outage hit, some visitors trying to access CNN.com got a message that said a Fastly error, unknown domain. Attempts to access the Financial Times website turned up a similar message, while visits to the New York Times and UK government sites returned an error of 503 service unavailable. The National Council of Canadian Muslims says it is beyond horrified by a vehicle attack that killed 4 members of a family in London, Ontario on Sunday. The organization calls it a terrorist attack on Canadian soil and says the government should consider terrorism charges while prosecuting the accused to the fullest extent of the law. The organization says in a statement that Muslims in Canada have become all too familiar with the violence of Islamophobia while attacks on women in Alberta and the Quebec City mosque massacre. Shakouet Khan Khan, a director with the Pakistan-Canada Association, also says the attack was intentional and called it mass murder. Samia Hassan, executive director of the Council of Agencies Serving South Asians, says losing children to Islamophobia and hate is very difficult. She says the community is shocked and fearful because they just might end up victims of a terrorist attack when out for a walk with their family. Canada's Minister of Public Safety said in a statement, while the London Police Service is currently leading the investigation, federal resources will be available to assist them. Bill Blair also added that Canada's Integrated National Security Enforcement Team, which is made up of a counter-terrorist security forces, is working collaboratively with local police. RCMP have also been in touch and offered its full support. The family was out for a Sunday stroll when they were run down on a sidewalk. A grandmother, father, mother, and teenage daughter were killed and a boy seriously injured.
Well, I will go on record and say, you were right, I was wrong. This morning it was raining. You said, just wait, and it turned out to be a beautiful day.
Yeah, see, always listen to me, Colette.
Yes, I know.
Never doubt me.
I don't know.
But I'll tell you, next week's going to feel cool, even though we're going to be in the mid-20s.
Yeah.
It's going to feel a lot cooler than we have this week.
Yeah, absolutely.
Enjoy this hot weather if you like this hot weather. Well, it's going to last all week long.
I love it. For Craig Huckabee and Jacob Moore, I'm Colette Linden. Thank you for joining us. Stay tuned for more news, sports, and weather coming right up.